Welcome to Inspiration Inc. I have a very special guest with us today who's known to wear multiple hats and who's also known as a turnaround specialist. I have with us NASSCOM Chairman, Mr. Keshav Murugesh, who is also Global CEO for WNS. Sir, thank you so much for joining us on Inspiration. It's a pleasure having you. In fact, I believe this is one of your early investments also became your employer also, ITC. If you can share that anecdote.
Oh, you've clearly done your research. You know, yeah. I'll tell you, by being a stockbroker or a sub-broker rather, I made a little money, right? Mm-hmm. Brokerage. And at one point in time, I had about 1 or 2 lakh rupees. And I had to invest it somewhere. So I was, I was actually on my bike on the beach road in Vizag, and I saw this beautiful poster. The poster said, meet the new Bond thriller in town. When I looked at it, it was, you know, James Bond standing with his gun and all that, you know, in the usual pose. But it was very interesting. It was actually an advertisement to sell ITC convertible bonds.
Okay.
But I said, it's such a creative ad. And ITC, we all knew, was a decent company as well. So I went and bought those bonds. So I invested, I got a full allotment. Over a period of time, those bonds kept getting converted, you know,
into
equity, and therefore I became a shareholder now. Mm-hmm. So for some time I got some interest. Over a period of time I became a shareholder, and advantage with being a shareholder in India is you get that beautiful shiny annual report. And as luck would have it, when I finished my CA, the only company that actually invited me based on my application you know, for an interview was ITC.
Okay.
And I went through, you know, two levels of interviews, very difficult interviews, I must say. And finally, I was sent to Calcutta for a final interview. And I must say that annual report came to really good use, because at that final interview, I was the only one selected in that particular attempt to meet the finance director. He started asking me a few things.
Mm-hmm.
And, very quickly, I was able to position what I had learned from that annual report and all the mistakes in that annual report, and impress upon him the fact that I understood some of the ITC businesses quite well even before joining. And therefore, after coming, I would probably be an asset.
Mm.
And of course, I got the job. Very fortunate, and what a wonderful career I had at that company.
Right. Having this reputation of a turnaround specialist, it's something which comes with a lot of responsibility. And you know, not many people, I mean, if you look at the global businesses, not many people who are considered turnaround specialists are very popular. You are one of the few people I have met who manages to turn around businesses without really making people bleed or making the organizations bleed. How do you manage that?
So, Mayor, I am no turnaround artist, I must tell you. I'm a popular guy, right? So let's reverse it. Okay. I'm a popular guy who spends quite a bit of time in terms of just understanding people, my team, their strengths, sometimes even their weaknesses, and then using that as a strength, right? And around all of that, and a strategic kind of mission, creating a value proposition, creating a mission for the company, creating the right values, and then having the whole team align around that common cause, right? And, you know, I've been very lucky because in the last two stints, both were very difficult, you know, turnarounds, and everyone gives me the credit. But the reality is, I'm no real turnaround artist. You know, there is no such thing as a turnaround artist. When someone takes a role, their job is to make sure that they do their best at that role, and they deliver the kind of results that are required to all stakeholders. And a very important stakeholder is the employee, right? The person who has actually bet his or her entire career on that company.
Right.
And with both the companies I went into, I realized that very quickly. Here were people who were good inherently. Nobody had really focused on creating the right strategy, the right differentiation, the right, you know, set of values. And I did that along with the help of 40 of my, you know, senior leaders at the company. We have made some very tough decisions, and I can tell you that, you know, in order to do some of these things, you also have to take very tough decisions. So it's, you know, you might say that, yeah, I'm popular with my people, but that's essentially because, you know, I try to understand them, and they understand me as well.
You have taken multiple initiatives in your roles at different companies, starting with ITC. If you can just share with us some of the memorable, I would say memories which have stayed with you.
Sure. So I'll tell you, ITC was a really great experience. I joined them in their audit department, did a very interesting audit of one of their companies, and thereafter got positioned directly with the corporate finance treasury department. Very quickly, while in that role, I met with the deputy chairman of the company, who was an ex-finance director himself, and who was looking at recreating the value proposition of ITC based on the board's mandate. I got very interested in that when he told me that, look, I'm sitting in a role where, you know, I have some resources, I have no people, I have no clarity of vision at this point in time, but my job is to really help people appreciate that ITC is beyond just plain tobacco.
Right.
So I actually went down and told my boss at that point in time that, hey, I don't want to work with you anymore. I'm now going to work with this guy because he has a much more interesting mandate. So as you can see, I was risk-taking, you know, quite young in my life. The rest is history, because I went, I worked with him, and a small group of people got together under that team. And we created a number of very interesting companies, which all did extremely well for a period of time. But I think at the end of that period, what happened was ITC got known as a company that was well beyond tobacco. It was seen as a diversified company. And since then, they're doing a lot more in diversification. My last assignment was really to create a company called ITC Infotech, and that's when I realized the potential really for the next 50 years in India is going to be the IT side.
IT.
And for two or three years, you know, we did a great job in recreating ITC Infotech as a brand. But somewhere I again felt that I would be better off doing it for a pure technology company.
Pure
and that's
company.
How, you know, Sintel happened for
Correct.
Me. And again, how did that happen? It was essentially a search firm coming and telling me that, you know, here is a role for a Detroit headquartered company. You may suit it. Why don't you speak to the founder? I spoke to the founder. I was very impressed with what I heard from the founder. I had not even met him. And I accepted right there on the phone based on the vision he painted and what I thought, you know, I could do. And more importantly, the desperation, frankly, to get out of a tobacco-oriented company
right.
being in IT into something that was
pure IT.
A pure IT services company, but doing quite badly at that point in time. So I went in there as the CFO, and very quickly I realized that the opportunity was far beyond that of a CFO. It was founder-driven. I found that the strategies that had worked in the past were no more relevant. There was no HR, there was no proper controls, and there was huge opportunity in the marketplace. So in a very disciplined fashion, quickly, you know, helped with changing the model from a, you know, onshore-centric model to much more offshore-centric model, put in core HR, worked with an external, you know, kind of consultant that I brought in from the US to really redefine the mission of the company, the values of the company, the differentiators, the strategic orientation, and get the whole team aligned around that. And fast forward a few years, you know, as we started delivering, everything changed. The financial metrics changed, the whole market cap changed. And towards the end, you know, I helped put together a very powerful business process, kind of a joint venture for that company, which transformed that company.
Correct.
And, you know, so, you know, from a $200, $250 million market cap when I started, when I left, it was close to $3.5 billion.
Right.
And how did that also happen? It was very interesting. I was actually in Chicago or somewhere, and I kept getting this call saying that somebody wants to, you know, meet with you. So I said, who is this? And they said, it's somebody from Warburg Pincus. And I said, I never heard of this firm. This is also a very well-known, you know, private equity firm, and you should try and meet with this person. And I said, I don't want to, because, you know, if this person is looking to offer me a job, I'm not interested in a job, because I've just created the vision for the next 10 years of
Correct.
The last company. And then anyway, this call kept coming, and then finally the person said that, look, this person has realized that your last departure is from Chicago Airport. Right? And he's also going to be in Chicago, so why don't you just meet him at the airport before you leave for India? So I said, look, I shouldn't be rude. So,
yes.
you know, so I met at the Hilton Hotel right outside the airport. I set certain conditions saying 45 minutes at the Hilton, I will meet and I'll leave from there. So I go into the Hilton at the airport. I see This gentleman stands up as soon as I walks in, because I'm the only Indian there, so he knows he's meeting me. We shake hands, and he says he's a partner from Warburg Pincus. Then I said, how do you know about me? He said, Frank, I never didn't know anything about you before this. But you know, I'm the person who actually put together the WNS deal years ago. And the company has done well, and since then has not been doing that well over the last 2 or 3 years. And you know, we've been doing a search to get a new CEO. But everyone we go to says that you are the right person to turn the company around, and you're the only person who can do it. And I said, that sounds silly, because I've never heard of your company. The people you're talking about, you know, I really don't know them.
Right.
But he said, you know what, I also don't know you, you don't know me, so let's have lunch. So we just had lunch, we chatted. I was not serious at all. And at the end of the 45-minute period, Meera, I stood up and I said, look, Jeremy, I need to leave. My plane is leaving soon, so I'll go into the airport now. So nice to meet with you, and I don't think there's anything more to discuss, really. He also stood up and he said, I'm paying the bill and I also have to leave. So I said, where are you leaving to? So he pointed out and he showed me a British Airways plane. Hmm. And he said, I just arrived on that plane 2 hours ago from London, and I'm flying back to London on that plane. See, that's when the penny dropped. So I said, did you fly all the way here just to meet me? And he said, absolutely, because somebody, you know, a few people said, you're really worth it. So that's when I said, you know, I will definitely look at this opportunity, understand about your company a little more, give me some material. You know, till then I was not very serious. I went through that material on the plane, and here it was, my mind was made up by the time I landed in Bombay, because I said, great brand, great legacy, very interesting business, fantastic roster of clients, absolutely no strategic orientation, which is future proof, and great, you know, set of people, you know, available at this company. And I said, you know, that whole entrepreneurial bug hit me again, saying, if I was able to turn around an IT services company, as a leader, would I be able to turn around a pure business process company? It's that challenge, right? And so I said, let me, you know, take this job. And that's it. Within a week, I was at WNS.
Wow. Now for you, when you picked up, let's say, Sintel or WNS, and when you knew your task was cut, that you have to turn it around and make it future proof, you know, strategize and everything. So which are the basic rules which basically drive your conviction or drive your actions? Is it your childhood learning? Is it your mentoring that has happened over a period of time? How does it happen?
So I'll tell you, I strongly believe in one saying. Mm-hmm. First and foremost, in anything that you do, work hard, like as if everything depends only on you, and pray even harder, because I think the rest depends on someone above.
Correct.
Right? You got to also do both of it, and you got to have a bit of luck as well. And I think for me, when I look at an assignment and I look at, you know, what I could do with that assignment, I try to model it around a few simple things. Right? First and foremost, what is the business that area is in? Is it something that is growing? Does it have potential? You know, the company is not growing. And how do you, you know, how can you position it as a different business over a period of time? That's one. The second is, how do you attract talent and people who are far smarter than you, you know, into that business, surrounding yourself with people like that, right? I think I've been very lucky. I have been able to attract really good people into any of the companies any business that I've run. And I've had a very stable management team because of many things, because of the culture we built, because of the kind of people that were available, because of the results we delivered, and to some extent, because of how they perceive me as a leader as well, right? Along with that, I think it's very important that you involve the key leaders and the key players in actually deciding what this company should focus on, what the differentiation should be, and how to invest behind success. We have done that extremely well, you know, at WNS. The first thing I did was to do a Gallup survey to understand, you know, what 15,000 people felt about the company and the management. And it was, the report was a real horror for me. When I read the report, the one thing that stood out was, while there were many positives, they didn't trust management. The associates said, we don't trust the senior management because they don't share, what the strategy of the company is. And we don't know, for the last 9 months, what's happening at the company. And we don't even know where we are headed. That is something that was, is unacceptable.
Correct.
So the first thing we said is, we created something called a strategic planning exercise, which I run even today. We call it the Seven Samurai. It is very motivational for our people. We brand it and position it extremely well. But from the first meeting, we have always had 30 to 40 people to come in to the meeting from across all levels of management. And from that, we originally wrote the first mission statement of the company, where the focus became completely innovation and driving, new things, as opposed to just saying, we'll be good at operations, right? The circle of values we wrote at that point in time, and the circle was very clearly defined, something that every one of our 15,000 people then, 42,000 people today can say. Circle stands for client first, integrity, respect, collaboration, learning, and excellence. Simple words that everyone understands, and the entire framework of reward and recognition at the company is driven around some of this.
Right.
Then the key differentiators. We said we will go to the market, around end-to-end vertically aligned business, while the whole market was going horizontal.
Correct.
We said we will drive non-linear models of growth, right, driven by technology. We'll cannibalize our own revenues, but we will build trust with clients who will see us as giving them a technology-enabled, outcome-based kind of model,
right.
And we will create a very strong culture driven by our client partner, program, where, across our 13 locations, we were 3 or 4 locations, we are now 13 countries. We said we will do it in such a way that we actually have very senior people from the business domains walking the corridors of our clients. The rest, I would say, is history. So I think these are the key things that we focus on. And around all of this, for us, integrity is a qualifier.
Right. So what has been the most satisfying moment or achievement for you? Something which comes first to your mind.
Look, for me, I would say the most satisfying, situation from a corporate point of view would be the day when, after the big turnaround of WNS, we were able to, through 2 secondaries, actually help Warburg Pincus exit this investment after many years.
Right.
Right. They exited at a solid premium to whatever they had invested in. They made quite a bit of money. But I must tell you, what is inspirational for me is the fact that in the last 3 years since they exited all their investment in WNS, the stock price is actually up 5 times. So the new investors have also made a lot of money. The culture of the company continues to be strong. The delivery mechanism at the company continues to be strong. The talent and the people continue to be very, very motivated. And the growth momentum at the company continues to be very, very positive.
Right. Any decision that you, when you reflect now, in hindsight, you feel if you would have done it differently or if you would have acted differently, that would have been better?
I don't regret any decisions I have taken. I must be upfront with it, because you must understand, an entrepreneur can only see light at the end of the tunnel.
Correct.
A good professional manager or an entrepreneur never sees failure. They only see point A and point B, and I'm like that. If I want to do something, I will get after it and I will get it done. And I know I can't do it myself, and that's the clever strategy that I implement. I have the best people around me, right? If there is one thing that I could have done better, I feel, it is probably underestimating the importance of the transformational change that technology would bring into this business.
Right.
And implementing a technology roadmap maybe 2 years later than I should have. It has not really caused any negative impact, for the company. But when I look back, I feel that, as a manager and as a human being, you're all the time looking at the rearview mirror sometimes to understand, what you could have improved. I somehow felt that somewhere I should have seen that 2 years before we actually made the big investments in technology, brought in our chief technology officer and you know, did some of that, we should have actually done that. And I must tell you, my board of directors were pushing me in that direction and kept asking me, right, about it, whether we were doing it, you know, a little late. And at that point in time, I said there were so many other priorities, I didn't feel it was that necessary. The good thing is, it has not impacted us. We were able to manage somehow. But we may have delayed outstanding performance by maybe a year.
Right. Anything that which is like an unfulfilled dream for you, which you wish to do, or something. I mean, it could be personal also.
Unfulfilled dream. Oh, you know, something.
Or desire or something.
My only unfulfilled dream here was, I would have loved to play cricket for India. It has not happened. But I can tell you, I'm so happy that today in this role, I'm able to host boxes.
Correct.
With clients and my colleagues. And
okay.
Of course, sometimes Shamini joins me as well. But we are able to see the World Cup. We are able to see some, you know, wonderful, you know, sporting events and see the way that sport has developed in this country and the kind of respect and impact that, you know, cricketers in this country, you know, have. It's wonderful. And it's important for me because, like I told you, my mother was involved with cricket. My father was a very well-known cricketer. My father-in-law was a very well-known cricketer from Madras, and I played cricket for the state as well. So, you know, for me, the only unfulfilled wish I would say is, I always wished I would play, you
cricket.
Know, you know, for India. I didn't.
Right. There must be youngsters who must be watching this interview right now, who are at the beginning of their journey, you know. What would be your message to them? What would you like to share with them?
Once again, I will say, work very hard, like as if everything depends on you. Pray harder, like as if everything else depends on God. I think the most important thing I would tell any youngster is, this is the most important phase taking place in the world. Mm-hmm. One, you know, you can see from a political point of view itself, how countries and how leaders are interacting, behaving, and the kind of inspirational leadership that we are now seeing, you know, across the world, led by our own country and the Prime Minister of this country and his team. You know, inspirational, if you ask me, the kind of thinking, the kind of models, the kind of programs that are being run. That's the first thing. The second thing is, what is happening in terms of technology and technological disruption that is impacting every business, and the fact that any smart person today need not, you know, only be looking for a job. If they can leverage some of these changes and create businesses behind them, they could actually be creating new jobs for others as opposed to looking for a job. So I actually think that, you know, this is the time for a lot of young people to put their good thoughts together and look at starting to create new businesses and also participating in other businesses. But the potential for growth, the potential for change in India, and the potential for them to be successful, make a lot of money, is here.
That's
right,
true.
And it's the most exciting phase.
On that note, thank you so much, Keshav, for joining us. It's been a very interesting conversation. Thank you, and all
thank
the
you,
best.
Thank you, Mihir. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.